The Project Kuwait. Learn.
Have you ever wondered why you're not losing weight? Have you ever wondered what affects your weight loss? Well, today we're sitting down with the functional nutritionist, Lulwa Alarmali, and she is dropping knowledge bombs left and right, going into hormones, cortisol, and supplements, well, for a brief period. So stick around, listen to this interview, and you'll come out with some questions. Oh, and by the way, if your dietitian tells you to eat McDonald's, do not do it. You'll find out a lot more in this episode. So without further ado, here is Lulwa Alarmali. All this and more in today's episode. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the project. And today we are joined by the functional nutritionist. And we got Liam back on board, back from China.
I'm back. Hey, how's it going?
So the functional nutritionist, literally like the, every time I hear the functional nutritionist, I'm thinking like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. I have no idea why, because you got so many things in your arsenal. Yeah. Your Instagram is awesome.
Thank you.
You practice what you preach. I love what I saw yesterday when you're trying out the eggs and steak for breakfast.
Yeah, steak
right?
and eggs.
Right?
Yeah,
steak
yeah,
and
yeah.
eggs for
yeah.
breakfast. Trying to, what is it, influence the hormone profile. Yeah.
There's this, not this theory, but there's this concept of hypertrophy, which obviously hypertrophy depends on muscle protein synthesis. The common concept of hypertrophy is being in a, requires you to be in a calorie surplus so you can put on muscle mass. There's information that has come out a long time ago, but it's being popularized now by Dr. Gabriel Lyon. This information states that you need a certain amount of protein to trigger muscle protein synthesis per main meal. So you're better off having a high amount of protein for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, or maybe like a fourth meal, in order to trigger muscle protein synthesis. So I'm trying that out instead of just focusing on complete calories in.
Yeah, yeah. I went to the Arnold Schwarzenegger approach, what they used to do in the 80s.
Well, I thought what they used to do in the 80s was more about like having consistent stream of amino acids in your bloodstream.
Well, it was that. And like, you know, their breakfasts back then were like 10 eggs and like, you
yeah,
know, steak.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was
yeah.
just, it was high on the protein side.
Exactly.
And like, it's a lot of, I love it because a lot of things that bodybuilders were talking about back then, it's coming to fruition now when, you know, the medical experts are finally saying, all right, you know, we'll take a look at this.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
So how's the experience been so far with that?
I literally just started.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Obviously, I have to train accordingly as well.
Yeah.
So I'm doing a 4-week intervention and I'm seeing how that goes.
So what about cholesterol levels? Do you worry about that at all? Because
no.
I know there's been a correlation, or I've read
yeah,
this
yeah,
in
yeah.
a couple of studies, that there's a correlation between having high cholesterol and higher testosterone. That the, you know, the
yeah, okay, I can understand why, because cholesterol is a precursor to cholesterol can be a precursor to sex hormones. So for there are certain, well, men and women, if you reduce the total amount of cholesterol in your food, you actually do get reduced levels of sex hormones. And I don't worry about consuming cholesterol, because you're just not gonna, like, I'm eating for my needs. I'm not overeating. I assume if I'm eating 10 eggs for breakfast, that's probably going to do some harm to me. But I do limit it to like 3 eggs.
Okay.
And some steak.
All right. Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. What about you, big guy? How many eggs do you have for breakfast? I'm just curious.
I'm rocking like 8.
Oh, that a boy. That a boy. That a boy. That a boy.
But I'm probably a little bit heavier than you, I would guess.
I think you're like at least double my size. At least. Yeah.
Well, our
yeah.
first show, I said that he was 6'7".
Yeah.
And about 400 pounds. And then our second show, I reduced it to about 6'2"
yeah.
and 300 pounds. So.
Which is closer?
I'm like 6 foot, I think. I think I'm just over 6 foot, but I don't know how many pounds I am. I'm like 115 kilos.
Yeah.
So what's yeah, that, like definitely more than double.
250,
my
something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, so 8 eggs is where
right,
I'm rocking
so you're
at
eating 4.
I'm eating 4.
But, I've found, like, just having a higher protein breakfast has massively helped, though. Before,
yeah.
I would kind of, like, have, like, maybe 3, 4, 5, something like that. Like, 5 if I was hungry.
Yeah.
Then since having, like, towards the higher ranges, like 8, then probably sometimes, like, up to 12 in a day.
Okay.
In a day. Like, not 12 in one go.
Yeah.
But, like, just increasing that, like, especially at breakfast time, I found, like, energy-wise, I've actually, for the rest of the day, been
That's
so
awesome.
Much better.
Do you eat them every day?
Most days.
Okay.
Like, it's kind of like a fullback breakfast. Like, I just know that I can just make.
Do you go full eggs. Yolks or do you do 4 and 4? I usually do, like, if I do my 4 eggs, because, yeah, I'm happier sized.
Yeah.
So I'll do 4 eggs, 2 yolks, and then, you know, 4 egg whites.
I'll usually just put all the yolks in as well. Like, because I tend to eat like kind of less fat throughout my day, unless I'm kind of having like red meats and stuff like that. So I kind of saw that I was like needing to get those fats in, needing to get that cholesterol in as well. But also, I used to have a lot of egg whites and I didn't feel great off it. So yeah. Like kind of my diet is kind of like a little bit more like I was like, try things, see how I feel. And yeah, I just felt amazing from having so many eggs.
That's cool. So let's dive into some of these questions that I actually sent you.
Sure. Yeah, let's get into it.
But actually, everyone wants to know how they can up their testosterone and, put on some muscle bulk. So, I mean, you can't go wrong with that.
Actually, if you could, maybe we'll discuss it in the...
No, go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, if you cover the basics, you should be set. Like, the problem is people ignore the basics and go straight into, testosterone boosting supplements or even testosterone supplementation where they're injecting testosterone. But if you do the basics really well, you will have an appropriate or an optimal secretion of testosterone. And the basics include managing stress, sleeping, because those things affect something called the hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis, which is something in your brain that tells the testicles to produce testosterone. So if you optimize that, you'll optimize testosterone production.
Okay.
All right. That's quite simple. Yeah.
Yeah. No, it makes sense. I mean, when I was sleeping more.
Yeah.
Before having a child, and I actually got a lot of sleep, it was easy for me to put on muscle. And even a couple of years ago, when I wasn't stressed out at work, and I was going to bed like at 8 o'clock, waking up at 5:30 or whatever, and I'd hit the gym, dude. It was like magic. I'd lean out in a month and a half.
Yeah.
Again, I was 34, 33 at the time, so there's a big difference. But I mean, it makes sense. It totally makes sense.
Yeah.
So why are you so passionate about nutrition?
I don't know if I'd say I'm passionate about nutrition as in food per se, but I'm really passionate about the human physiology. I just think it's incredibly fascinating how our body is composed of so many different systems, and these systems interact with each other. And in order to influence one system, you want to look at a different one. And I just genuinely think it's so fascinating how you can improve someone's health just by adjusting their physiology. And nutrition or food is the key to that. Even when you're talking about improving hormones or improving specific organs like liver function or thyroid function, some of those things depend on nutraceuticals or some of those things require the help of nutraceuticals, which is still rooted in nutrition.
What's nutraceuticals?
Oh, okay.
let's bring it back down to the average guy so that everyone, the office guys are understanding. He knows what you're talking about probably, but I have no clue. All right.
Okay. Very simple. Nutraceuticals are basically just supplements composed of herbs or nutrients in super physiological doses or higher doses than you would need in a maintenance phase to induce a certain response that you're looking for.
Oh, okay. All right.
That's simple enough.
Can we break it down a little simpler?
Basically supplements. So if if you're trying to improve your health through supplements, that's still nutrition because they're nutrients or herbs.
Okay.
Or concentrated food.
Extra things to add to your diet to help you achieve a goal.
So the omegas and the vitamin D's and, whatever else.
Exactly.
All right, that's pretty cool. Now, what are some of the biggest misconceptions that you've seen in Kuwait and in the Middle East? We were talking about the bodybuilders earlier, about the hypertrophy stuff.
Yeah.
And how they eat and how you see a lot of these guys that, or I see a lot of the guys on Instagram, I don't know about you, that say, cut carbs. What's your take on that from a nutritionist, a functional nutritionist perspective? And if people are looking for the hypertrophy of it with the performance?
I think that the reason there's so much controversy about it is because it really depends. There's always controversy about topics when high carbs works for a certain group of people and then low carb works for a certain group of people. And everyone's imposing their views on what worked for them. The thing with carbohydrates is it depends on your physiology. So if you are a very healthy person, you have good insulin sensitivity, and good insulin sensitivity basically means that when you do eat carbohydrates, your body can use it and process it for energy and store it in muscle. Okay. If you're healthy and you have good insulin sensitivity, carbs are amazing. There's no need to cut them out. You can actually use them to lean out if you want to. You can use them to improve performance. You can use them to sleep better. But the problem is for people who have insulin resistance, which can occur up to 10 years before it shows up on a blood test. for people who have insulin resistance, they can't process carbohydrates efficiently. For that person, low carb would work better for a short period of time when it comes to body composition, but it may be detrimental to their performance. Because we know that when it comes to athletic performance or bodybuilding, carbs are king. Maybe not necessarily for hypertrophy in terms of like the physiological response, which we were just talking about, like muscle protein synthesis, but definitely for endurance training, anything that requires high levels of glycogen. So bodybuilding, like if you train 2 times a day, if you do Liam, you add to it, like what kind of training requires high volume?
So like anything where you're lifting heavy weights, right?
Yeah,
so like you want to produce a, if you're trying to produce a performance in that kind of, you want to deadlift even like 100 kilos or 150 kilos or 300 kilos,
yeah,
like it's going to be something that's explosive. It's going to be something
exactly
that requires carbohydrates. If you're
exactly
doing sprints, if you're doing high intensity interval training, you're trying to lose fat, like it's going to be things like that, which are going to, if you want to be running faster, then you're going to need carbohydrates. Right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. And also it doesn't have to be an all or nothing approach. So for people who, so let's say like a lot of women try to lose weight. So the common thing that they do is they do a lot of high intensity interval training and they cut out carbs because they think it's going to lean them out. But the problem with that is if you cut out carbs, you actually reduce your power output. So you think you're training really, really hard, but because you're really tired because you don't have carbs to fuel your workout. But, you know, in reality, your power output is really low, which means you don't actually burn as much calories or as much fat as you would if you had a small amount of carbs in your muscle glycogen. And that's definitely something you can manipulate by maybe going lower carb, but not zero carb, or eating post-workout to replenish muscle glycogen stores, or eating before you sleep, again, to replenish muscle glycogen stores. So, it's a complicated way of saying it. Really depends on the person. Like, it depends on your goals.
That's what I love about you, the message you usually preach on Instagram. Last night, you had a post where you're like, I'm taking A, B, and C because I've been traveling a lot.
Yeah.
And then you said, I don't post my supplements
because
it depends on you.
Exactly.
And it's so true.
Yeah, because I got a bunch of messages being like, oh, like, you know, what did you, like, can you please give me the supplement name? And I was like, I blocked it out on purpose because I did. I blocked out the brand and the supplement name. Because there's, you know, you and I can have the same symptoms. And I say this a lot, like two people can have the exact same symptoms. But unless you understand human physiology well enough and you understand like the person's history well enough, you're not going to be able to treat effectively. Because, you know, I may be extremely fatigued because of one kind of dysfunction. And you could be extremely fatigued because you're not getting enough sleep. So I can't give two people the same nutritional approach or the same supplemental approach if, you know, if their histories are different.
That's actually... And I think that's the best part, you know, about why I follow you on Instagram.
Yeah.
No, it's following the legit people these days.
Yeah.
Because when someone comes on and they're like, oh, you know, this supplement, this, and this. Okay, but that might not suit your body
exactly
type. You know, that might
exactly
not. I mean, me and Liam could go lift the same amount of time, same amount of weight. Well, same amount of time. Yeah, I took back the same amount of weight. we could go and both lift for 2 hours.
Yeah.
And then he's fine after workout, but I feel that hunger. You know,
yeah.
Like I had a tough workout on Wednesday. Yeah, on Wednesday. I had a pretty tough workout on Wednesday. I wasn't feeling good. But ever since that workout, I added 2 other exercises and I've just been eating nonstop. It's like every time I see food, my body's just telling me, feel me, feel me, feel me. Whereas, you know, someone like him could go and, you know, he'll be fine after a workout and, you know, nothing affects him.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's what I love about some of the things you post. It depends on you.
And yeah.
That's the best part.
Yeah. And I think when I say functional anything, like functional nutrition, it's about understanding. This is why I say I'm interested in human physiology, because it's understanding how the body works and then different people respond to different stimulus in the environment differently. They respond to, you know, food differently. Their genetics are different. Like we were just talking about genetics. Something I find to be really interesting is there's this common, well, it's not a theme, but a lot of people talk about detoxification and they promote detoxification supplements. And they say, you know, if you have too much estrogen, then you can take this supplement that detoxifies too much estrogen. But if you don't know your genes, then you can't really give anyone detox supplements. Because some people's like phase... Okay, I'm going to try to explain this in layman terms.
All right. So, I'll ask questions. Don't
worry. Okay, good. Okay, so we have 3 phases of detoxification, okay? Phase 1 takes toxins and turns them into reactive intermediates. Okay?
So would that be like toxins as in heavy metals, stuff like that? Okay,
yeah.
All right.
Yeah, environmental pollutants.
Xenoestrogens.
Yeah,
exactly. Okay,
all
right, okay.
So So you take toxins, phase one takes toxin and turns them into reactive intermediates. Now, you don't want reactive intermediates because they're very reactive. They can cause free radical damage, DNA damage, mitochondrial damage. So you want these intermediates to be switched or transformed into phase two.
What does mitochondria do?
The
easiest way, just so you could break it down for the listeners.
Energy production.
We
say energy production, we're talking about actual energy. We're talking about ability to utilize fat for fuel, ability to utilize carbs for fuel. So fat loss as well falls into energy production. Mood falls into energy production. A lot of people with dysfunctional mitochondria actually have mood swings because it's also in your brain. So,
okay. All right. Yeah. Awesome. No, awesome. Yeah. All right. You could continue on that point. We're going to circle back around to the fat reduction.
Yeah. So, okay. Phase one transforms toxins into intermediates. You don't want intermediates. And then phase two kind of takes these intermediates and makes them excretable by the body. Okay. So people who have really high phase one or who have an upregulated phase one detoxification pathway will produce a lot of intermediates. And if you give someone a detox supplement that only has phase one support, thinking you're going to like upregulate their liver's ability to detoxify, you're actually creating more intermediates that the body can get rid of as efficiently because you're not also supporting phase two. So they end up worse off than if you had just given them no supplements whatsoever. So does that make sense?
I'm looking at Liam. Yeah, that makes sense.
What you're saying is if someone's been recommended a detox supplement,
yeah.
And it might be, there's hundreds of different detox supplements out there, but it might be a supplement that just only helps with one section of the detoxification pathway. But that one section, and if in itself, when it's not connected to the other sections, can actually be more harmful than good.
Exactly.
So yeah, so if that one person who has a problem with that section is doing more and that the supplement is helping that, it's not helping the actual person get rid of anything.
And that depends on genetics because some people have an upregulated
because phase everyone's one. Different.
Yeah, right? everyone's different. So
when you break it down to like the average person, when their nutritionist or their doctor or someone says, "Oh, you definitely need a detox." What are some of the first steps they should take before they go and do a detox? Should they get, blood tests done? Should they get any testing done beforehand? Because these days, detoxing, like you said, is a hot topic.
A lot
of people are saying go and do it. The supplements that are being sold. Now, what would you say to caution people, before going ahead and doing something like that?
Okay. I can answer that in a long way, but I'm going to try to condense it. So basically, most nutritionists don't know how to actually detoxify. Like, I have seen your average nutritionist, like, detox protocol. It's calorie restriction, some form of fasting, some form of clean food. Yeah, juicing. I'm not a huge proponent of juicing because it just doesn't provide your body with the required nutrients to actually detoxify. So unless they're giving you supplements, they're probably not harming your detox pathways. They're just really not enabling your body to detoxify because detoxification is very complicated. The easiest way to detoxify is to remove exposure to toxins. Okay. And then we can get into that later because I know it's related to hormones as well.
Yeah.
So caution wise, just be wary of anyone who's giving you supplements if they haven't like fully explained what they're for, if they haven't fully explained why you need them, if they don't have data to back up your need for these supplements. And I will go to say that people who are well informed in detoxification should know what supplements to give and what not to give. But then just make sure they're not your average typical like dietitian or like, PT turned nutritionist, which I have nothing against, but like, you can't be recommending detox supplements if
you
don't have a background.
No, I agree with you 100%. And I think that's one of the things we stress on this show is everyone that comes on here, everything we talk about, we want to make sure that it's the right background, giving the right information to the right people that need it.
Exactly.
So speaking of that, circling back to one of the things you said earlier, what are your views on metabolic damage through caloric deficit and increased exercise? Because I just a little bit of a background. We were chatting a week or two ago. And I brought up a workout modality. So we could get into that a little bit later after this. That's why I threw this question in there, so we could talk about it a little bit.
Okay, I'm curious to know what you guys are talking about. Okay, so let's separate metabolic damage into two categories. True metabolic damage and perceived metabolic damage. There are, a lot of people think they have metabolic damage because they diet and they don't lose weight. And there were some studies that show that people who were convinced they had metabolic damage were actually overeating by 1,000 calories and weren't aware. Like, or they thought they were eating like 1,200 calories and were actually eating 1,000 calories more. So it's really important, first and foremost, to track what you're eating so you can actually discern whether or not you have metabolic damage. And then from another perspective, like, we can look at true metabolic damage, which does occur with prolonged calorie restriction. And it occurs through the calorie restriction's effects on our hormones, notably the thyroid. When we talk about metabolism, we're really talking about our thyroid function mostly. So what happens is, like, when you're in a prolonged calorie deficit, you put some kind of stress on your body. So you have like physiological stress, and you also you also send the signal to your body that you're in some kind of starvation mode. And your body kicks in into this evolutionary process of protecting you from starving to death. So it actually downregulates your thyroid. The problem with that is, for people who do strict diets, let's say for like 2 to 3 weeks, not strict, but like severe calorie restricted diets for 2 to 3 weeks, when you go back to eating normally, your thyroid doesn't recover. So you would have metabolic damage for someone who's like yo-yo dieting. They eat like really low calorie, and then they go back to eating what they were normally eating, and they gain weight on it. And then they restrict again, which means their thyroid function downregulates again, and they go back to eating normal food, and they gain weight. So every single time they diet, they're actually damaging their metabolism more and more and more. So it does exist. It's just that you have to be really honest with yourself about whether you are actually restricting your food or not. And the only way to do that sometimes is to track, like using my fitness pal or food logs or something along those lines.
Well, my fitness pal is a good one. I've used that previously in the past.
Yeah.
You can't really go by the macros per se, because I mean, it's some of the macros I found discrepancies between my fitness pal and three other sites I was using.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, I found it with white rice mainly.
Interesting.
Yeah, like that was the biggest discrepancy I found. Mm-hmm. And it's like, but at the end of the day, if you're tracking and you're within 70%, I think would that be a good benchmark
for
people? Yeah,
exactly. And also, so the way I write my meal plans, like the way I calculate the calories and macros for my clients, is probably different than the way someone else does. And it's probably different than the way a meal company calculates macros. But the thing is if you're consistent with one person, then the difference in the way you're eating will still elicit a response. So let's say I'm trying to put someone in a consistent calorie deficit. So I start 1,800 calories based on my way, and then do 1,600 calories based on my way, and then do 1,400 calories based on my way. They're still probably getting like that 200 calorie deficit, whether it's actually 1,800 calories or 2,000 calories. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that makes sense. That definitely makes sense.
Yeah, so the same way with my fitness pal. If you're using like the same, let's say you're tracking steamed white rice and you use that same, what is it called? Like that same choice every single time, and use it like for a prolonged period of time, then if you're increasing your food intake or decreasing your food intake, it will reflect.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. That definitely makes sense. Now, here's a question for Meg, because she's not here. Sourcing your food. You'd mentioned like a meal prep company.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what about when it comes to sourcing your food? We have a lot of meal prep companies that are jumping out on the market, right?
Yeah.
And I'm not saying they're all bad, and I'm not saying they're all good. I don't have a preference to any of them.
Yeah, yeah.
But I am saying, she always talks about, Meg's talked about sourcing your food a lot and where it comes from and how clean it is and whether it's organic.
Yeah.
And, you know, now what about these meal prep companies? Because some people will say a calorie, you know, a calorie is a calorie. But in reality, I mean, I'll let you answer that. It's not, right? I mean, like a donut isn't equivalent to eating, you know, if a donut's 300 calories, it's not equivalent to eating 300 calories of something, you know, good and organic, like, you know, meat and, you know, sweet potatoes, for instance.
Yeah. Well, I don't like referring to food as like good or bad, generally speaking. There are certain foods that have like beneficial effects, and then there are certain foods that have negative effects or detrimental effects to your body. But if we're looking at them in terms of calories, and if you want a beneficial effect versus detrimental effect, something that's super processed, your body is not going to expend so much energy to digest it because it's so processed. Like, you don't have to break it down. You don't have to break down the fiber. You don't have to digest and assimilate, you know, like proteins. Like, it's already it's very easy to digest. Versus if you're eating a salad with protein, you have to spend a lot of time digesting that food in order to like extract nutrients from it. 300 calories on paper from a salad is more or less. So 300 calories from a salad is very different than 300 calories from a donut, because you're actually going to spend more energy digesting the salad than you will the donut. So you'll be in more of a calorie deficit from eating salads than you will be from donuts. Whether or not that's enough to create a noticeable difference? I don't know. Like, is it like 3 extra calories or is it like 300 extra calories expending that, I mean, digesting that food? I don't know. But definitely, there's a definite difference.
And what about exercise? You know, like over-exercising and, you know, like how that can, I've heard you can over-exercise and damage your metabolism through over-exercise, you know, over, mm-hmm. you know, just over-stressing the body. What are your thoughts on that and your background? Because you are a personal trainer too, right?
Yes.
So
strength and conditioning coach.
Strength and conditioning coach. Sorry.
It's different.
So when you're talking about exercise, you can think of it as over-exercise or under-recovery. Ideally, in an ideal world, you could be exercising really hard, but then fueling your body by eating a large amount of food to fuel your workouts and sleeping really well and making sure you're not putting yourself in your body in an inflammatory state. So I'm just arguing that people can exercise a lot if they take care of themselves in every other way, okay? And that may not necessarily count as over-exercising, but whether or not you're over-exercising or under, whether you're over-exercising or under-recovering, you are going to put physiological stress on your body, and your body perceives stress the same way. Whether that's mental stress or life-threatening stress or physical stress, it's going to have the same exact reaction. So if you're training really, really hard for a really long period of time, not recovering enough, not eating enough, you're going to raise the stress hormone called cortisol. And when you raise the stress hormone, cortisol actually inhibits conversion of thyroid hormones from an inactive form to its active form. So when you have a lot of physical stress, you don't get the active form of thyroid. And I just said like thyroid is your metabolism. So your metabolism slows down and you do get metabolic damage because of the amount of stress you just placed your body under.
Oh, okay. All right. Wow. That's some deep news right there. that's some good stuff right there. No, because like I was, you know, me and Liam, now I'll tell you what we were talking about a couple weeks ago.
Give me some context.
Yeah. No, I wanted to see what your view was before I threw it out there. Just so I wouldn't taint your opinion. No, because I sent him a post.
Yeah.
Of you know, a couple of fitness modalities mm-hmm. that it's basically 30 minutes of cardio. I mean, it's 30 minutes of cardio. You'll mm-hmm. gain some muscle out of it, but it's cardio, right? I don't want to say what. Well, whatever. PX90 and Insanity and those modalities. You know, where, because I got a guy at work, he was asking me about it. He was like, yeah, you know, I'm doing this new thing, the PX90. I said, that's great, but can you keep up with it? Mm. You know, long term, do you think you can continue doing it every day for 45 minutes or 3 times a week or however you're doing it right now? And he's like, yeah, maybe. I was like, okay, but what are you eating too? Because eating has a large part. He's like, oh, no, I'm eating somewhat clean. I said, okay. So now somewhat clean plus 45 minutes of vigorous activity, mm-hmm. you know, 4 times a week. Can you do that for 3 months? Because after a month, you know, if you stop or if you reduce it, you're going to see everything start to slow down. Because he was saying, oh, the scale's dropping 1 kilo every day or whatever, which it's going to. I mean, water weight and all the other stuff. But in reality, when you look at those modalities, it's short lived.
Yeah.
Unless you're an intense athlete that can keep up with it. So, yeah. I mean, what are your thoughts on that? And the main reason is because it does, in some respects, it's going to teach your body to hold on to calories a little bit more once you get past that phase. You know what I mean? Well, unless it doesn't. I mean, you're the expert, not me, so.
Okay, like, you know, like, I think we were I don't know if we were talking about this on this podcast or before, but you know how I said, like, sometimes it's about sticking to the basics or, like stripping things down to the basics?
Yeah, you said that right at the beginning. The basics.
So before looking into metabolic damage, if someone like is training 4 to 5 times a week really intensely and reducing their calorie intake, they're going to be in a negative energy balance, which means they're going to be burning body fat or maybe even breaking down muscle for fuel. Okay. Once they can't sustain that anymore, their energy deficit is going to decrease. Like they're no longer going to be burning as much energy or as much calories as they were when they were training 4 to 5 times a week and in a calorie deficit from food. So, you know, why look at metabolic damage from that instead of just saying you stopped burning as much calories? So you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It can be metabolic damage if, like I said, if it's really prolonged. Like if it's really prolonged, they're not recovering, they're not fueling properly. Yes, you can get metabolic damage. I think it's more complex than that, but in the case that you're describing, I think it has more to do with energy expenditure than it has to do with metabolic damage.
Okay. All right. I wasn't trying to offer an opinion on that. I was just saying,
like, if you're going to do something like that, and then you say you do it for 4 weeks, like, you might have a January New Year's resolution to do it for four weeks.
Or to lose weight for the wedding that you're going to, and the guy knows who... He knows himself. Okay, so he's going to a wedding, and he's like, So say you have an event,
and, like, that's really, really normal. Like, I've trained loads of people over the last year who literally were training for wedding season.
Which is crazy.
I mean, like, if it gives you a goal to work for, then, power to you. Like, it's great. That's really good. If it gives you a reason to actually go to the gym and start doing something, then whatever it is, fantastic. But say you have that event and you leave it till the last minute, you've got 4 weeks left. Like, what you're trying to say is, okay, do whatever you got to do to increase your energy expenditure. Obviously, like, eating clean or somewhat clean or making more effort than you're currently doing is fantastic. But you have to be aware that when you stop doing that 3 times 45 minutes a week or whatever, you can't continue to eat the same amount of food that you were eating, because your energy intake is still going to be high, but your energy output is going to be much lower.
Exactly.
So if you're going to stop, then that has to adjust.
Exactly.
Because it's okay to stop it, because you might change the exercise that you're doing. You might go to yoga, or you might kind of be burning less calories than in your week. But then, as long as your calories go down for your input, then you're still going to see changes, as long as that calorie balance is correct.
Yep.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. Well said.
Yeah, I'm glad you're here.
So 80% of the population do what Liam just said. Don't go lose the weight, over 4 weeks. Because that's what most people do. They'll do it for 4 weeks. Yeah. They'll lose the 5 or 6 kilos or whatever. Then they'll continue to eat the same, and then weight just shoots right back up.
The place you'll see it most is actually over a longer period of time with guys who were athletes, in high school.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So they were active all the way up until they were, 25. And then, they, had a knee injury or something like that, and then they continue to eat the same amount.
Exactly.
For the next 10 years, and then they're I'm fine. I just ate a little bit more. And then they try and go back in, straight back into, full-time exercise, and then they injure themselves.
Exactly.
And they're what the hell? And they're wondering why they got fat and why their knee still doesn't work. But they literally were doing everything right, but then they stopped, and then they just kept putting that energy in.
Yeah.
So, that's probably where you most see it. And again, especially probably in this region where you especially with the guys, you have guys are fairly active, they're playing football and everything like that up until end of high school. And then after high school, it's end of, finished.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so true.
Especially guys who go abroad to universities as well, they play a lot of sport, and they get into the sporting culture there and everything like that, and then they come back home and then they literally
sit
on their butt.
Completely sedentary. Yeah. There's nothing to do.
So I think that's where it's kind of tough for people. But as long as you're adjusting your calorie intake, then actually you can do a little bit less. You could probably liken it to traveling as well. Like, people tend to do a little bit less when they go traveling, if they're going, because people here go to London for a month, or they'll go to Thailand for 2 or 3 weeks, longer than most people would go on kind of holidays. Mm-hmm. And so they might not train for that period of time. And so actually, just as long as they're adjusting their calorie intake, then actually you can continue to achieve your goals.
Dude, this was my first time. I went to, me and my wife go to Boston every year. We were talking about that earlier.
Yeah.
And we went for 4 weeks, and she's just gone on to the whole strength binge for the last year. So she's like, I don't want to lose my strength.
Yeah.
And she was a beast in Boston. We were there for 4 weeks, and she was going to the gym religiously every day at 6 a.m.
Awesome. Oh my God.
Yeah, she was hardcore. And it was great because it pushed me to go to the gym.
Yeah.
And it was the first time I went on holiday and I didn't gain the fantastic five. Yeah, usually I gain 5 kilos. If I go to the States, I'm gaining 5 kilos just from, I eat horribly.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
I eat horribly.
Yeah, there is, you do enter a holiday mode. You can't tell me that most people over the Christmas period have not indulged, just because, there's this whole vibe of, let me just, relax, kick back, take a break, so.
Man, as soon as you get to the airport now there's Picchio there. It's frozen yogurt.
We're not sponsored by them, dude.
Not yet, but Picchio, if you're listening, I'm real interested.
You've got your number one fan over here.
Big time.
Actually, two. My kid loves Pick.
Yeah.
So, all right, since we're talking about Pick, all right, and nothing against that, because I think their food's great. It's pretty clean from what I've seen. But what do you think of some of the dietitians or health experts or physical trainers or, whatever, people in your industry, when they recommend processed foods to their clients, such as diet cookies or diet yogurt, and you're a nutritionist too. I want your take on this because I can't say I know for a fact, but my personal opinion is, in the research that I've read, is, you know, additives like sucralose mm-hmm. are bad for you. Mm-hmm. And all the other stuff, you know, the 50 other ingredients they put into these diet cookies or diet yogurts. What does that do to your gut? And, like, what does that do to your actual system?
Okay, well, first of all, I don't, like, when these dietitians recommend these things, I don't think they're doing it maliciously. Like, I just genuinely think they don't know any better. Because, you know, like, a lot of people ask, like, what course did I take to get into functional nutrition? And I'm just like, it's just a lot of research that I've done and reading a lot. Because in university, they teach you energy in versus energy out. And then they also teach you, like, medical nutrition therapy.
Wait, so they don't go into gut health? They don't go into... Really?
No.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's
absolutely
insane,
not.
Dude.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Not. It's a like even with medicine, like there's still a very conventional approach where like you're not looking at the body as a whole, you're looking at the symptom. So if the symptom is weight gain, then reduce calories. You know what I mean? But maybe the symptom is actually, there are a lot of different causes that are resulting in these symptoms. Anyway, so I just don't think dietitians know any better. I don't think they're malicious and just like, eat diet cookies because I want you to get sick.
I know. What I mean? And that's what I was getting at. Like if you don't know, like in your field, when I go to a dietitian, like I have a family member that went to a dietitian and they're like, yeah, just eat KDD ice cream. That's okay. And I'm like, no, KDD ice cream is not okay.
Exactly.
Because you're still consuming processed sugar. You're still consuming all that crap that shouldn't be in your body, essentially. So it's like, these are people of, like, they're people of influence.
Exactly.
And
I know.
They're sending out some of the wrong messages to people. And it's, you know, it could make things worse.
I know. And it's funny you mentioned that because that was actually, like, that's widespread, especially in the Middle East. Let me just talk about Kuwait. Like, one of the reasons that I was actually worried about seeing clients in Kuwait was because I was like, you know, who's going to listen to me when I tell them not to eat gluten, when every other dietitian is like, eat a piece of toast with cheese for breakfast. And then if you want McDonald's, you can have it 3 times a week. Just make sure it's like the small cheeseburger.
Wait, you're kidding me.
I swear on my
life. No, you are kidding me, dude.
100%.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh my God, dude.
I'm dead serious.
Liam, we got a lot of work to do, buddy.
It's all about like if it fits your macros or like calorie reduction. I personally haven't met any other nutritionist in Kuwait that focuses on improving health through food as opposed to getting results through either calorie reduction or calorie manipulation or macro, like changing up your macros. But yeah, like I was genuinely scared. I was like, you know, nobody's going to listen to me when you have like literally like 20 other dietitians telling you can have McDonald's 3 times a week. But thankfully.
That is scary as hell.
It is really scary.
That is really
scary. I know.
Now I know why my family members aren't losing weight, dude.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Now I understand it. Like, now I'm getting it. That freaks me out because these are people of like you go to a doctor and you want the information. You want the right thing. And then you take what they say and you're like, okay, the doctor said I have to do this. I'm going to do this.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. And they have like full trust and faith in you. And then, you know, maybe these changes have a good short-term effect where being in a calorie reduction will help you or where, you know, you'll be able to sustain your diet because you're able to have everything, you know, everything that you like or sugar or fast food. But the fact of the matter is processed foods will have a long-term detrimental effect on your health and they will give you the opposite of what you want if, you know, like 6 months to like 2 years or 10 years down the line, depending on how well you process toxins and how good your detoxification pathways are. Yeah, but they can affect your body in so many different ways. You mentioned gut health. So artificial sweeteners can actually alter your gut microbiome. And we know that your gut microbiome has a lot to do with inflammation, has a lot to do with how you extract nutrients from foods. We know that processed foods are inflammatory and inflammation can mess with your hormones. Like if you're in a constant state of inflammation, like for men especially, you will aromatize estrogen. Which means whatever, you might be producing testosterone completely normally, but whatever testosterone you're producing, like a larger portion of it or a larger portion of like more than what should be have, your body's switching this testosterone to estrogen. So you end up with symptoms of high estrogen, like body fat distribution, and symptoms of low testosterone, even though your production of it is perfectly fine. And we know that like inflammation is an underlying pathway for a lot of diseases, including autoimmune diseases. Something like Hashimoto's, where your body attacks the thyroid gland and you lose thyroid function, which means you're going to, you know, if you don't address it from a functional perspective and you just like trust a conventional doctor, you'll be on medication for the rest of your life. And still, you know, you're still going to struggle with symptoms of hypothyroidism, like difficulty losing weight. What else? And yeah, processed foods has a lot of toxins. It has pesticides, it has hormone disruptors, it has, you know, estrogens. So women can get symptoms of estrogen dominance or like PMS or PCOS or infertility issues.
What's PCOS?
Polycystic ovary syndrome. Where they have...
Okay, because I'm looking at you like with two heads. I'm like, all right. We don't know.
So if
you could explain that to the females that listen to the show, that would be awesome.
Okay.
Especially how it can mess with their PMS symptoms or their PSOS?
PCOS, yeah.
PCOS?
Liam's looking so at me like... It's so interesting to me.
Where's Meg when you need her?
Okay, PCOS. PCOS is polycystic ovary syndrome. You may have, like exactly as the name says, a lot of cysts on your ovaries, or you may just have symptoms of PCOS without actually having, more than usual cysts. The symptoms of PMS include things like acne, weight gain, especially around the middle. You get symptoms of like male hair pattern growth, like hair on your chin, a thicker mustache. You get male pattern baldness, so like you start losing hair where men would usually lose hair if they were aging. And the pathophysiology of that, which basically means how you get PCOS, is usually one of two things. It usually is a result of chronic inflammation or a result of insulin resistance. And inflammation affects or contributes to insulin resistance. And when you have insulin resistance, you basically affect your ovaries' ability to... Well, they produce more testosterone than they should. And with insulin resistance, you actually generally will produce more testosterone for a female. So...
I hope that clarifies it to females.
So if you have PCOS, they'll usually go to a doctor and the doctor will just put them on something that improves their insulin resistance.
So what can women do? What is there
first
a doctor
foremost,
they can go to? Like,
they can come to me.
Okay. All right. There's your plug-in, by the way.
Accepting DMs.
In Dubai and Kuwait.
In Dubai and Kuwait, yeah. Yeah, so what they would do is first and foremost, clean up their diet. Again, this is a condition where depending on their insulin levels and depending on their blood sugar levels, these women will most likely do better on a low-carb diet. And while they're on a low-carb diet, you provide their body with nutraceuticals, which improve their insulin sensitivity. That means when they reintroduce carbohydrates, they can actually process them and use them for energy. Because otherwise, the more carbs and sugars they eat, the worse their symptoms are going to get. And reduce inflammation.
That's some deep stuff right there.
It's pretty simple.
That's a lot. You got to come back on the show. We got to do a whole whole episode just on stuff like that because we're running out of time right now.
Okay.
So I wanted to get in two more questions.
Okay.
One of them is if you had to pick three supplements,
high quality fish oil. And I do say high quality fish oil, not the cheap stuff. This is not stuff you want to skimp on.
Do you put it in the freezer so that
Does that
do anything? I've read somewhere if you put it in the freezer and it doesn't freeze up, that means it's pretty good.
Oh, I've never heard of that.
That's what I heard, and I read it on a blog, and I tried it with two different supplements.
Yeah.
And sure as hell, one of them, which is a supplement that's widely sold here, froze up, and the other one didn't. So.
That is so interesting. I actually didn't know. The way that I make sure that I'm getting good quality supplements is that I deal with three supplement companies because you can trace where they got their supplements from. And I think each product has its own certificate of.
Okay.
I'm not exactly sure, but
it's
a certificate. Okay.
So omega-3s.
Yeah. Good quality fish oil, magnesium.
Okay. I got that.
It helps with sleep. Most people are deficient in magnesium and it's good for recovery. It's good for sleeping. It's good for hormonal function. It's good for metabolizing estrogen or metabolizing bad estrogen. And it's really, really good for PMS. And it's also been shown to reverse depression. In two weeks.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it is. If you take high dose, 600 milligrams a day, even women, okay, I'm not going to give specific doses.
I was just going to say, everybody out there, there's no specific dosing.
Yeah.
None of this is medical advice.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. None of this is medical advice.
Liam, you okay with that, buddy? Because he usually pipes me down when
really?
I'm like, yeah, when I go and stuff like that, he's like, nah, man. He's like, nah, keep it down.
No, it's just, I think we talks about it earlier where people take something like that and be like, okay, I have
exactly.
to have 600
yeah. yeah, 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 exactly. No, no, no.
And everyone's obviously different.
Yeah.
And you're just kind of referring to
a study. Exactly.
A study that was made based on a high dosage that it kind of proved that this happened. But
exactly.
actually, it could happen at lower dosages depending on the person as well.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What's the third one that I would recommend? probably just a really good multivitamin.
All right.
Because
okay,
even
cool.
if you eat really clean and you eat really well, like our soil no longer has a really good amount of minerals and vitamins. So crazy statistic. I don't know if it's a statistic, but crazy piece of information.
Tough getting that one out.
To get the same amount of nutrients from one peach from the 1950s or like 1960s, you have to eat 53 peaches.
Oh, that makes sense, dude. That's totally crazy. Makes sense. Yeah. Have you ever heard of Paul Check?
Yes, I
Paul Check is awesome.
Yeah.
He talks about that in length, about how our soil's been stripped away of all the nutrients and everything.
Yeah.
It's so true. We've destroyed so much of it. So it makes complete and utter sense. But
So those, a good multivitamin.
Those are the three.
Yeah.
And now the next question is, what is your current project? As we are the Project Kuwait, trying to make Kuwait our project and bringing them smart people like yourself.
What's your project? You're putting me on the spot. Okay, my current project. I am planning. Well, I'm working on getting.
Yeah. So you said you were kind of starting to work on bringing your business over to Kuwait, right?
Yeah. Okay. So my current project is to be to split my time evenly between Dubai and Kuwait. Eventually, with the intention of moving back to Kuwait full time, I would. Yeah, I'm honestly just working on like developing my brand, and by that I don't mean like a brand to like market or sell, but just like making sure that as I grow, I stay authentic to myself. I give out like good, practical, implementable like information. And I also have a project of trying to put on 2 kilos of lean muscle mass. So.
Oh, well, the eggs and steak, my
Yeah,
help.
The eggs and steak. Yeah.
But dude, that's awesome. And I love what you said. And that's Thanks. That's why, you know, I wanted you on the show because
Thank you.
You don't sell. You're not,
No.
You're not
sell,
a seller.
Yeah.
You're not, you're not a snake oil salesman that's out there trying to sell themselves 24 hours.
Exactly.
And I think that's the best part about some of the people like you, you know, like
Thanks.
You're not on there just promoting yourself. Hey, you know, DM me so you get so you get, you know, you can come in and whatever.
You're,
you know, you keep it real, which is awesome.
Thanks.
So
I try to.
It was great having you on the show.
Thank you so much. I had so much fun. This was awesome.
Definitely a phenomenal experience. And I know I have a whole list of other questions for you. Like, without a doubt.
Yeah, I think we're going to need you back on.
And I'm going to bring another female on. If Meg's
awesome.
Not back,
I'll bring
a female on so she can ask the questions we definitely didn't ask.
Well, maybe it's a good idea that we do ask the questions because we actually have like very little knowledge on kind of like female hormone side of things and everything as well. So, because I know there's a lot of guys who are actually very interested in that from a guy's perspective about like how they can help like their like female partners, their mum, their wives, whatever it might be, their sisters and things like that.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of people who like they kind of say like the brothers or whatever might be in the fitness industry, but they're trying to help their families. Actually like kind of having a knowledge of that. And I don't think we should just think that only women want a knowledge.
Oh, no, I'm sure. Also, men definitely do. And it's stigmatized in our society, right?
Yes.
And that's one thing. Like if you could come back on and just talk about
female hormones
and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Like, dude, I think that would be beneficial for a lot of women.
Well, I'd also like to talk about male hormones as well, because in my field, like especially when it comes to like functional nutrition or anything functional, I actually see the opposite. I see a lot of people focusing on female hormones because they are really complicated. Like a man's hormones changes like 6 times in a day, but a woman's hormones changes over a 28-day cycle. Like that's intense. Like a man will relatively like be in the same mood day after day, whereas a woman's mood or the way that she feels or, you know, like mental symptoms or physical symptoms or whatever change on a 28-day cycle. So because it's
being
so
married
complex,
for 12 years, being married for 78 years, I know.
You know,
So, I'm very aware of that.
I hope Kay is not listening to this part.
But I feel like because it's so complicated, there's so much attention focused on females, but there's actually like equal amounts of information about male hormones and about like the brain, like I said, the HPG axis and how to enhance your testosterone levels and, you know, when is the right time to take testosterone injectables or testosterone replacement therapy. Like a lot of guys don't know that if you take testosterone, it actually acts as a male form of birth control. Like it sterilizes you within like 3 to 4 months and it's really difficult to get your like function back.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
And you know what? There was a study that showed 25% of urologists were actually prescribing testosterone therapy for men with infertility because they don't understand how the male body works.
Oh my God.
And it actually makes them infertile. Yeah. So, there's still like, there's, you know, because I'm a female, I don't want to be pigeonholed into talking about female issues as well. Like, I would also like
discuss
like, you know, male issues because that's also underreported.
Now, I got a couple questions for you after the show
with some
of the supplements that I'm taking before a competition that's coming up. So I went out, I got my subs for the month, and I'll run them by
later. Yeah, we'll discuss.
No, definitely. But No, it was great having you on the show.
Thank you so much.
And hopefully we can get you back on here. Would you like to come back on?
I would love to come back.
I'll put you on the spot.
No.
I know. Imagine she's like, no, dude, I'm never coming back on this show again. You guys suck. You know, like, you got the American and the Brit over here. What's going on?
No, I had so much fun.
All right. That's awesome. Great.
Cool.
Great.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for listening to this episode. If you enjoyed it, please head over to iTunes to subscribe, rate, and leave a review. You can also find us on Instagram at the Project Kuwait. Thank you, and join us next time.